It was a line that was carving up a nation in two countries. A bloodline that ran through cities, towns, villages, even homes and hearts of millions of people. Cyril Radcliffe's pen was lacerating the Indian anatomy with surgical precision. And when the Englishman was through with the abominable task that history had bestowed on him, some Indians beheld the remains of the cataclysm, concerned and sad, very sad. Lahore, where he had demanded complete independence from the colonials, was no longer his country. The vivacious and colorful Punjab was left without a capital. The wounds had to be healed. The pride had to be restored. It was as though Jawaharlal Nehru and his fellow nation builders would invoke the goddess of strength, Chandi, to anoint a sleepy hamlet, a barren wasteland, into the capital of Punjab, Chandigarh. India was vastly divergent from that of his political mentor and spiritual guru, Mahatma Gandhi. Nehru envisaged bustling townships, cosmopolitan in their makeup and served with modern amenities. Cities in the mold of new and planned townships of the socialist Europe. In the words of Pandit Nehru, "Let this be a new town symbolic of the freedom of India, unfettered by the traditions of the past, an expression of the nation's faith in the future." March 1948. The government of Punjab, in consultation with the central government, approved 114.59 square kilometers of the then Ambala district as the site for a new capital city of Punjab. A global search was launched for an architect who would translate the amorphous structures in the realms of Nehru's mind into elevation drawings. An American architect duo, Albert Meyer and Matthew Nowitzki, were chosen for the job. The Americans did some preliminary designs. However, Nowitzki died on his way to India in a plane crash. The design was still born. The search was relaunched. Indian missions the world over began identifying professionals who could be entrusted with the job. Among the ones shortlisted was a man who had an awesome reputation as an architect and town planner. An architect who belonged to a country famous for its collective sense of aesthetics, France. Nehru handpicked Le Corbusier. S.D. Sharma is one of the leading architects of modern Chandigarh today. However, 50 years ago, he was a rookie who had found a job with the Public Works Department of Punjab. For the young architect, it was baptism by fire.
I remember one time he said, "What could be the height of this table?" I said, "Approximately this much." And he immediately said that, "Don't use ever this word approximate. Everything must be sensed correctly, measured, and unless you have a perfect idea of a thing, should not be told."
The brief before the architects was one that was born out of Nehru's vast exposure to various cities of the world. Wide tree-lined colonnades in harmony with its environment, green, orderly, with up-to-date civic amenities comparable with the best. Chandigarh was to be a city of the world.
It is one of the best in the world because it is not a local city. It's not a city of India. It is a city of the whole world.
S.S. Bhatti is a professor of architecture who won the President's Award for his doctoral thesis on the architecture of Chandigarh.
in my study of this city, I figured out that there is something about this city which is so small in size and in population, but so big in genius.
The master plan of the city was conceived as a living organism by Le Corbusier, with the capital complex in the north as its head, the city center as its heart, the open spaces of the lungs, the network of roads as the circulatory system, the industrial belt as its viscera, the cultural and educational belt as its intellect.
The strongest point is that it's a very clear conception of three basic cardinal principles of modern planning, which he enumerated as sun, space and green.
On the 2nd of April 1952, Pandit Nehru laid the foundation stone of Chandigarh. The man known as the architect of modern India remarked, "The site chosen is free from the existing encumbrances of towns and old traditions. Let it be the first large expression of our creative genius flowering on our newly earned freedom." On the 7th of October 1953, Chandigarh was inaugurated by the first president of Free India, Dr. Rajendra Prasad. The city continued to evolve with every passing year. It is widely acknowledged that Chandigarh is one of the largest urban complexes of the post-war era and is a successful experiment in 20th century urbanism. It is one of the great planned cities of India after the grand Fatehpur Sikri near Agra, Emperor Akbar's capital, and Jaipur, the capital of the Rajputs in Rajasthan. However, the success of a social democrat's vision as opposed to the monarchs of medieval India had to be reflected in the experience of the common man. In a city that showcases India post-empire, Subhash Gulati runs a shop called the Empire Store. Attracted to the halcyon charms of Chandigarh, his family chose the city over Delhi to settle down.
We had a house in Punjabiwar and we wanted to do business in South Extension. So it was, the distance was too much. So my father and the educational wise also, it was all far off places one has to go. So my father decided to come to Chandigarh. And being Chandigarh being very neat, nice, upcoming city, and all the educational facilities were there, so we shifted to Chandigarh.
The sectoral plan of the town was a unique innovation introduced in Chandigarh. Every sector is a self-sufficient unit with a market and other infrastructural facilities, contain activities within their bounds. Each house has its own share of nature's bounty, with verdant open spaces, playgrounds and front lawns.
The object of Chandigarh plan was to make the best environments for the human beings, which can provide quality of life at every level, from poorest to the poor. Poorest of the poor, when I say that in government servants, even the peon was given a back garden and a front garden, and at least a two-bedroom accommodation. Whereas in British days, there was just one room and a veranda. In a veranda, a small corner was cut for cooking purposes and things like that.
The cityscape of Chandigarh is a pragmatic mix of the functional and the aesthetic. This may well reflect the personalities of both the visionary and the architect. Romanticism blended with practicality. Just as Nehruvian socialism emphasized India's diverse and rich cultural heritage, Le Corbusier transcended the constrictions of a classical architect and gave his creativity a free rein.
Corbusier was an urbanist, architect, philosopher, thinker, painter, sculptor, multifaceted personality. Something like in the past, like Leonardo da Vinci or Michelangelo. A great thinker.
However, the gathering pace of city life in Chandigarh is a lot faster than the way the city evolved in its early days. Known as the city of retired people, Chandigarh was a languid, laid-back city.
Most of the retired people come and settle here. Most of the, I think, Indians settled abroad, and we call NRIs. They also want to purchase property here.
Hiralal Sibbal is a well-known lawyer who was at his prime in the decades following the partition. His thriving practice in Lahore was disrupted, and he was relocated in Shimla following the transfer of the Punjab High Court. Hiralal ji came to Chandigarh and established his practice once the Punjab High Court came about in the new city in 1955. While his son Kapil Sibbal has shifted to Delhi and is regarded as an eminent jurist of the Supreme Court, Hiralal ji prefers Chandigarh, even though he rues its gathering pace.
Although not as bad as in various other towns like Delhi, like Mumbai, or Chennai, or Bangalore even, Calcutta, there are so many bad towns here. But Chandigarh still may be better. There is an attraction to the people to come to Chandigarh because it caters to the three states.
Hiralal Sibbal, like many others of his generation, could hardly have predicted the evolution of India post-partition. In 1966, Punjab was divided into the states of Punjab and Haryana. The city itself became a union territory governed by the central government. Chandigarh acquired the unique distinction of becoming the capital city of two states. The grandeur of the capital complex of Chandigarh is in consonance with the immense importance of the city in modern India. These structures house both the governments of Punjab and Haryana. It comprises three epoch-making masterpieces of Le Corbusier: the Secretariat and the High Court. Juxtaposed in harmony with the Legislative Assembly, separated by large piazzas, form the crowning glory of the cityscape of Chandigarh. And in the center stands the giant metallic sculpture of the open hand, the official emblem of Chandigarh, signifying the city's credo of open to give, open to receive. The soul of a city is often to be found in the institutions that come about along with the city's evolution. The pulse of Chandigarh can be felt in the premises of this newspaper. The Tribune is synonymous with the new city it came up in. Like many an old resident of Chandigarh, the Tribune was born in Lahore and shifted to Shimla post-partition. Today, it has evolved in the image of a cosmopolitan city, assertive of its modern image and aware of its democratic heritage.
Tribune is totally identified with Chandigarh. We're talking about the habits of various things. It's a habit. Tribune is representative of Chandigarh. It was earlier in Lahore, from where it earlier migrated to, for a brief time, to Shimla, then came over to Ambala, then found its final quarters in Chandigarh. So it has grown with the city.
Amar Chandel is the scion of the erstwhile princely state of Ramgarh on the outskirts of Chandigarh. However, in the modern social fabric of democratic India, Amar's own dreams have got co-opted in the larger collective aspirations of the common citizen, once his subjects. Amar has observed the evolution of Chandigarh as a socio-cultural entity from close proximity.
You cannot expect the same kind of cultural activity in Chandigarh which you have in Bombay and Delhi. It's not possible. The size of the city is different, the culture is different. But even then, despite all those problems, it has developed a character. And you must also remember that the 10 years of terrorism, they've affected it badly. Despite that, look at the Punjabi strength and vibrancy that despite those problems, it has kept its character alive.
1958. A road inspector in the public works department wanted to indulge in his modest creative aspirations to create sculptures from the city's waste.
All the waste material which is thrown out on the roads or some behind the restaurants, hotels, wherever I get, I see, I used to collect, put in the bag and on my bicycle's back, bring it here.
For Nekchand, his hobby was almost a labor of love, a passion that drove him incessantly deeper into his creative pursuit, a pursuit that did not envisage returns or even validation. The process of creation itself brought about a sense of achievement.
Here in this area, there were maximum snakes, mosquitoes. So then even I was working here as a hobby.
Today, Nekchand and his rock garden have together emerged as institutions that underscore a modern, even an avant-garde expression of the city's cultural ethos. The garden itself is an open-air museum that showcases a vast array of natural rock forms and stones. The collection of these materials was a major task for Nekchand.
I used to work myself, I used to make myself, I used to bring by on my bicycle. So why the money to be spent on this? Everything was done with my own hands and everything on my bicycle.
The rock garden, like the city and its residents, do not assert a million-year history, but celebrate its present, even as it looks ahead to the future. While the other remarkable cities of India eloquently narrate a civilizational heritage, the romanticism of Chandigarh is to be found in the progressive attitude of the city and its residents. The golf club, usually a preserve of the rich and famous in other cities, is a favorite rendezvous for even the young.
Chandigarh has become fairly popular amongst the young people as well. There are discos, there are clubs, there are bowling alley and what have you. So I think Chandigarh is developing into that type of city where young people also find their modern pursuits.
R.K. Sabu is a prosperous industrialist whose head office is in Chandigarh. Though Chandigarh is better known for its thriving public sector units and other establishments that symbolize the state's drive to modernize India, incentives were given to entrepreneurs to set up shop in the city.
Chandigarh was never planned to be an industrial city, and all the industries had to come in the industrial area. At that time, there were limited industries, and the few major industries were our own needle factory, then one was Pfizer's and meters and instruments. So these were the industries that were coming up, but Pratap Singh Kharo at that time was giving all the encouragement, all the support, all the assistance for setting up the industry.
Chandigarh is a city that lies in the heartland of the green revolution of the 60s and 70s. The revolution itself, created by farmers and scientists, turned Punjab and Haryana into the granaries of modern India. The attendant prosperity meant new social dynamics that have become even more pronounced post-liberalization. Unlike the early settlers, the new breed of citizens are beginning to demand even more of their lives, and the city is adapting to these newfound aspirations. Chandigarh assumes an importance in the tourism map of India as the gateway to the picturesque hill stations up in the Himachal. However, for visitors to the city, there are several attractions to while away a weekend. The Sukhna Lake is a favorite watering hole for the townsfolk as well as the visitor. Yet, the citizens of Chandigarh candidly admit that the tourism potential of the city and its surroundings remains to be fully realized.
The tourism potential of Chandigarh has not been exploited to the extent that it should have been. In Chandigarh, all that we get is the transit tourist, somebody going to either Simla or Kullu Manali. So that is a basic problem. neither has it been properly advertised, nor has it been utilized.
However, a stone's throw away are the famous Pinjor Gardens, laid out in their classical style by the Mughals. In the context of the planned city, it is as though some Mughal oracle foretold of a magnificent city that was to come about and had them leave behind the gardens as a gift of posterity.
Pinjor Gardens, jaisa aap jante hain, koi 600 saal purana baag hai. Mughal style mein 5 terraces par wo bana hua hai. Complete Mughal architecture hai uski. To use ek tourist spot ke roop mein viksit kiya gaya. Aur aaj ke din mein agar aap Mughal Gardens baki Hindustan mein jitne bhi hain unse compare kiya jaye to aap dekhenge ki sabse acha maintained aur jisme lakhon ki tadad mein har mahine log aate hain.
Chandigarh cannot be described as a symphony in brick and mortar, nor is it an intricate raga in classical Indian tradition. It exudes a harmony in its fusion of styles, a fusion that encompasses the robust with the subtle, the traditional with the postmodern, in a unique whole that has a flavor of its very own.
It's a beautiful city. It's the city of flowers and gardens.
Atmosphere-wise, administration-wise, culture-wise, I think it's a very beautiful, good city to live in.
It is the place for people of all age groups, and it is a modern city. It is more or less pollution free.
I think it's a great city, one of the most important landmarks of world history in modern urbanism.
Keep on falling. Chandigarh was born as a direct result of a violent and black period of Indian history, the Partition. Yet, the city does not carry with itself an unsavory baggage of the past. It seems that every citizen of Chandigarh is resolved to look ahead, to share in the vision that brought it about, and to consolidate its own reputation as a city of the future. It is this attitude that has permeated the abstract designs of Le Corbusier to breathe life into the cityscape. And it is in this that we find the realization of a dream.